justification of pretty thin binary. So when an appropriation bill finally arrives, there's a bill. And NSF is actually five paragraphs. $8 billion, five paragraphs, five sentences, essentially. So it's done at so NSF gets an appropriation for research and related activities. That's about $6 billion. So that's all the research activities, one sentence, $1 figure. So that means NSF is then free to allocate that $6 billion as it wishes among physics, you know, astronomy, chemistry, etc. But alongside this bill, Congress also attaches what we call report language, so a committee report. So that for NSF is about three or four pages. And that three or four pages often contains suggestions, which from Congress are never really suggestions, for how NSF might allocate that money. So in that report language, Congress will say things like, well, NSF gets $6 billion for research. We would like NSF to emphasize, let's say, sustainability research. Not that this Congress would, or that we would like it to dedicate at least $120 million to the BRAIN initiative. So those kind of instructions also get there. So that limits the flexibility of NSF somewhat. But simply, you know, NSF, $8 billion, five chunks. NIH, $30+ billion, is 20 chunks, and et cetera. So agencies, once they get that appropriation, they have a lot of flexibility. But it's on the understanding that NSF is mostly going to follow the detail that they provided in the budget a year ago. And if Congress has an objection or some comments on that detail, then they'll put it into report language, which is optional, but every agency knows they have to go before Congress again next year, so you should not piss off the appropriators by not doing what they suggest you do. Yes?
Do you have to, or does NSF, as an example, have to prove that they follow the suggestions? Do they have to, like, present a report to say?
Yes. And often, in that report language, there's instructions saying, we would appreciate a report from NSF on, one example was on neuroscience research. And they tasked NSF and OSTP with providing a quarterly report on neuroscience research. And that took the form, you know, one quarter was just a phone call. Here's what we do with money. And another, it was a letter. So I mean, there are reporting requirements, and that's one way for congressional staff to make sure that the agency does what Congress is suggesting. So that is another component of policy. So that means policy people are writing these, and scientists, they're writing these letters and reports to Congress to keep them updated on what Congress thinks is important. Yeah, others? Yes?
There was a widely circulated story, I didn't look into how true it was, last month about the Trump administration limiting the language that can be used in CDC official documents with like evidence-based and science-based.
Yeah.
Do you know what the function of that, I don't know how true it was, but what the function of that would be within like the budget proposal, like would be tying their hands in terms of justification, like how much they could request?
So, yeah. That kind of thing happens a lot, not to this degree, but you know, it's, you know, what agencies are allowed to put in, you know, the volumes that it was, you know, 4,000 pages for Department of Energy. And so these are message documents, messages to the public and to the Congress. And so there's a lot of care taken on what language to use. I thought it was pretty egregious, this CDC memo, you know, if you can't use science-based in a budget document, for the CDC, I mean, where are we? But to a degree, every administration does this. I mean, for us, I will say that, you know, our instructions, we never wrote them down, but it said, do not say Obamacare. You are not allowed to say Obamacare in a budget document. And why? Because, of course, it gets a political reaction, and it makes it less likely for the agency to get an appropriation for a program. At the same time, you know, we also send positive instructions, like, you know, say, climate action plan, because it's important for the administration. So, you know, we want everyone to know that all of these pieces contribute to the climate action plan. So that kind of instruction does happen because, you know, agencies are not allowed to write these volumes and volumes of budget justification just on their own. There's some, you know, the White House also reviews that kind of language.
Follow up on that.
Yeah.
they told me it was internal things, like the CDC budget officer,
yeah.
was like, let's be really safe.
Yeah.
Like it wasn't
yeah.
coming down from the White
yeah.
House, you can't use these words,
yeah.
it was, we don't want to piss anybody off.
Right. That was my, part of what I think, why I think it was from OMB, but then relayed by CDC budget office, because of timing. When did this thing happen? It happened here, PASPAC. So, and PASPAC decisions are sometimes communicated by phone, because it's not feasible. So, what I think is that someone at OMB called the CDC budget office and said, okay, here's your PASPAC. By the way, when you're preparing your budget documents, as you will in January, here are a few suggestions for what words you might use or might not want to use. And then, of course, that got you know, relayed by the CDC budget office formally to agency staff. So that's why what I think happened, and I think that happened because of, well, now you know this. This is the budget process. This is how it's working. And this is the, why the timing of that is okay, let me tell another story. So let me tell you about OSTP. So where I was for 8 years. So the entire 8 years President Obama was in the White House. It's a long time, it's a long time. I was at OSTP. So OSTP, Science, Technology, Policy, it is an office that does it. So I was really happy because here I was working in Science, Technology, Policy and I got to do this in an office that was dedicated. So, you know, my role was primarily as assistant director for federal research and development. That means I was doing the budget. I was doing the budget for OSTP, meaning I was interfacing with my OMB counterparts a lot, making sure that the U.S. government science investments were, you know, keeping the U.S. science and engineering enterprise strong, but and also that it was contributing to making progress on the many challenges the administration wanted to make progress on. Including improving healthcare, dealing with the climate change challenge, improving our national security, et cetera. So it wasn't just about science. It wasn't just about policy for science. It was also about science for policy, making sure that we had the science we needed to make progress on some of these policy challenges that lie outside of science. So, you know, what you should like to go for a chronology of where it started. So it started January 20th. This is January 20th. Yeah, oh my God. That's only, that's 9 years ago. Anyway, January 20th, that's when it started. This is the inaugural ball. I was very lucky that I got that close to them in the inauguration because at that time, I was going to be working for John Holdren, who had been named as President Obama's science advisor for in December of 2008. John Holdren, was the president of AAAS in the mid-2000s, so I knew him then. And he knew me, more importantly, and in fact, you know, I think the reason that I got the job is that in one of his presidential addresses to AAAS, he used this chart of mine, because he wanted to make a point about federal research funding. So he knew that I knew federal research funding. And so when he was announced, I called John up and said, there's this job at OSTP, Assistant Director of Federal R&D, that deals with federal budgets for research. You're gonna need someone. Who else are you gonna call? So he said yes, so that's why I got a chance to go enter the federal government at the same time that he did. And so, as you might guess, there was a lot going on in the early part of the administration. So some of the things that I learned, because we had to get busy on making science policy right away in early 2009. So one of the things that I learned pretty quickly is that, you know, science policy is very much a contact sport. It's a contact sport, but you also need a library. You need documents. It's a contact sport because it's going to require lots of meetings, phone calls, messages, you know, socializing, networking, and personally making the case to people both in the sciences and outside the sciences about the importance of policies that we were trying to make at OSTP. But it also required the documentation. So each of us at OSTP had libraries. You know, they were National Academies reports, my charts, my pie charts and my line charts about the federal budget for research. congressional legislation, AAAS reports, decadal surveys, annual reports of federal government research programs, of course, all of those budget documents that I was describing earlier. So all of that was necessary, because every time we were going into a situation where I had to argue for funding for a research program, I needed the documentation to back it up. And it was really easy if I could just go to my office and pull out this documentation and then talk about it. But for OSTP, it was somewhat unusual, because OSTP is not a science agency. The OSTP, 100 people at the most, and as I like to tell people when people were visited, there's no laboratory here. We don't actually do research here. There's no laboratory down the hall. Instead, we are policy office. And we also don't have money. We have no grants officers. It was a budget of about $5 million, and that's purely for personnel and operations. It was the science agencies that had the funds to support research and education. So our function was very much as an organizer, as a community organizer, because of these 24 different science agencies that were around in the government. And to get anything done, it usually required assembling multiple agencies. So as I said, climate change research, it took 13 agencies. Physics research, it took about 8 different federal agencies. Manufacturing research, again, 7 or 8 agencies. So in any topic, we usually had to round up the right people in the federal government to, you know, make progress. So that was a large part of what policy making meant, you know, for me. So one policy example is the NSF's Graduate Research Fellowship Program. Are any of you aware of this? Are some of you supported by it? Oh, good. I love this part, because it's really, well, you'll see why. So on the campaign trail, President Obama promised to triple the number of new NSF graduate research fellowships that NSF awards each year, from 1,000 to 3,000 a year. We thought that, why? Because we thought on the campaign that it would be important sign of the federal government supporting, you know, U.S. scientists and engineers in pursuing their graduate research careers. So after the inauguration, you know, one of my jobs, because it was a budget, was to try to implement that campaign promise. So that campaign promise was policy for science, and it was a budget and funding issue, so of course I got involved. So every year I had to work with NSF, OMB, other agencies, congressional staff, to solve the problem. How do you design a path to get from 1,000 GRFs a year to 3,000? While all making it fit within the NSF budget, and convincing OMB, the president, and the Congress to allocate that additional funding each year. And also how to structure that program to get the maximum benefit. And then we also have to be adaptable, because we have to restructure that goal. It became clear early on that we would not be able to get to 3,000 GRFs a year. So we kind of fell back to 2,000, so doubling the number of GRFs instead of tripling. So again, spreadsheets, drawing boards, we had to like design a program that would make sense for getting to 2,000 GRFs a year. And it took some effort every year of the administration to make sure that we stayed on track. But the final result is that now NSF awards 2,000 graduate research fellowships a year, and that means 1,000 more U.S. science and engineering students are able to receive this fellowship than, you know, 8 years ago each year. So that, I count that as a success, but it also very much points out context. Lots of documents, lots of spreadsheets, a lot of phone calls and meetings to accomplish this, because, you know, translating a vision into actual policy and actual results, that's a large part of what science policy people do in the federal government, and that, of course, a role that you can play. Questions about that one? So, of course, you all would have made it anyway, even with 1,000 a year. But it's always good to see, you know, the NSF graduate research fellows around in the world. So, another lesson that I learned from science, from OSTP, is that, you know, policy rollouts are important. So, rollout, this word, was not really a part but I think I learned to use it and recognize how important it was. Because policies are, you know, government actions that have some kind of impact. But crafting a policy really is not sufficient, because policies have to be announced. They have to be pushed out into the world, and they have to be set on a path towards success. And that's why rolling out, or the act of pushing policies out in the world, is so important. So let me tell you about my first big rollout of several big policies for science, and that is this. I give my S&D policy students at GW the assignment of reading President Obama's speech in April 2009 to the National Academy of Sciences. He was the first president since Kennedy to speak to academies in the first 100 days of office. Because there's nothing like a president within the first 100 days, when public visibility and attention is at its highest, to use the power of a presidency to roll out policies for science and technology. So normally, you know, being good policy analysts and people, we would have liked to have, you know, taken our time to craft policies and to release them when we were ready. But when, you know, the president agreed to give a major science speech in April, we realized we couldn't waste the opportunity to announce. Policies with a big bang, with the maximum impact and staying power. So in the first few months of this administration, there was a mad rush to have a package of policies to announce. Because we couldn't just go present the president with just one thing. Because we wanted it all. We wanted to get the whole agenda done. Not that we were able to do that, but we came close. Because just a few words in a president's speech can make all the difference in a policy. So we packed that speech with content, with goals, with visions, and policies. Behind every phrase and sentence, including several that I wrote, were dollars, documents, meetings, workshops, phone calls, etc. But the net result was a lot of things, of policies that we were able to announce. There was a funding commitment. So the first one was to set a goal for the U.S. to invest 3% of its gross domestic product in research and development. I'll say a little bit more about that later, but that is a funding goal. That's a policy, a funding policy for science goal. The second was that the United States is committed to a clean energy future, and with a greenhouse gas emissions goal. Because at first it may not seem like a science goal, but we thought that it was, because it is, in order to achieve that, we needed to make investments in research. So it was a policy for science goal, but it was going to translate into new science to help achieve energy policy. So it is both policy for science and science for policy. In his inaugural speech, President Obama pledge to restore science to its rightful place. And for that, we thought that we needed a process to develop a scientific integrity policy. Again, that is policy for science. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. And then number four, we need to engage the scientific community directly in the work of public policy. He named the members of his PCAPS, or the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology. This is a group of 20 leading scientists and engineers from outside the government who get together periodically to advise the president on matters of science and technology. So this is science advice to government, or science for policy. So that was an important announcement as well. So this is like a pretty big package, you know, like a 40-minute speech. And we were trying to cover everything, not only funding policy, but also traditional science for policy, also a policy for science, all rolled up. And given like a big launch, because I mean, it's a scientific integrity policy, for example, may seem like kind of small potatoes, but when President Obama says it, it becomes a big deal, and we need it to be a big deal. All right, so my role in that was budget, right? So I had to provide the budget data. So when President Obama announced the goal of the U.S. is going to invest 3% of its GDP in research and development, where did that come from? Did he make it up? Well, in a sense, he made it up. But there were data behind that goal. The goal comes out of the data that we show here. Oh, the grid line went away. But it shows that at the time, the U.S., that's government plus industry, was investing a little bit less than 3% of its economy in research and development. It was about 2.8%. So 3% was an ambitious but achievable goal. It was realistic. And another reason that we set that goal was because some nations, Korea, Japan in this case, had already exceeded that. And we thought, you know, their economies, their innovation economies are doing pretty well. So that was another reason to just like that goal. So the goal came from the data, even though it was a political goal. I mean, that's all it comes from. The only reason you would say 3% is worth saying is if that is a political agenda for a president to pursue. But it was backed by data. And the goal was important because a goal is not a policy. Policy is how you get there to a goal. And it allowed us in subsequent years to come up with policies for how the US federal government would meet its part in getting to that goal. And that involved things like this, like laying out plans for how we might double the budgets of several science agencies. In this case, we're looking at the National Science Foundation, Department of Energy's Office of Science, and NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology. So every year, I would roll out this chart and see if we were making progress on increasing investments in these agencies as a way to make sure that we were heading toward that goal. So long story, well, it did not happen. These agencies' budgets are not at that level because NSF's budget does not exceed $10 billion. It's still around $5 billion. But it was a signpost. It was a set of policies we were working toward based on what the goals that President Obama articulated. Okay. Questions so far? Yes?
This is a question that seems blatantly political, but how solid is this, if you're describing this infrastructure that all of these career people create for a sophisticated president to select how the budget's covered, how does all of this suffer from when somebody has a total lack of experience and all of the political appointee roles, not only with President Trump, but with Oprah 2020, Buzz, all that kind of stuff, how does all of this suffer from that?
I think it does suffer. It's going to suffer in important ways because, well, just take this example. We would not have been able to accomplish even setting these goals and rolling out these policies if we did not have a president who ultimately understood every word of what he was saying, right, and believed it. Let's face it, that's missing now. So, President Trump would not.